Our friend, the president of the Mississippi Bankers Association, Gordon Fellows. Afternoon, Gordon.
Hey, Gerard, how are you? Thanks for having me back on.
You bet. It just seems like that the data, the guidance, the information keeps flowing from the nation's capital, which I think we're just accustomed to, with respect to stuff going on in your world, specifically related to the PPP. It kind of reminds me, I had this conversation yesterday, Gordon, before you get started, with some friends out of the golf course late yesterday who are business owners, and we were discussing the latest changes in the codification, and of course another round of some small business aid. It reminds me of when the Affordable Care Act passed back in 2009. I still think there are sections of the law that have yet to be codified here 12 years later, because it was so entangled and so complex and had so many moving parts. Once it got to the IRS, which is primarily part of the IRS code, they weren't exactly sure how to handle that, some of that stuff, weren't sure exactly what lawmakers intended in some of those provisions included in the law. This is a much smaller scale and not as complex. It sure looks like it's headed down that same path, though.
Yeah, you know, and I can't speak to the Affordable Care Act. That's way outside of my wheelhouse. I can tell you there are parts of Dodd-Frank that are still not enacted, and that,
okay,
that's a pretty
same
old
era
too right now. I mean, it's been around for more than a decade, and there's still pieces that have to be done.
Good point.
Which is, you know, we'll see what happens as the new administration comes in on all that. This PPP change, speaking of the new administration, is an administrative change. It's not part of the bill that passed yesterday.
Okay.
Although that did make some changes to PPP. The piece that I think is of interest to Mississippi business owners is a change that the SBA and Treasury made as part of the directive of the Biden administration, sort of the Biden administration putting their fingerprints on PPP. And honestly, I think I think in some ways it's a really good change for Mississippians. In some ways, there's some challenges for it too, just like everything else with PPP, right? Every
sure.
time there's been something new with PPP, there's been some good and there's been some bad. And the good news from this piece, I'll start with the good news, right, is when I've been on with you before, Gerard, and with Dave and others at Super Talk, Schedule C filers, 1099 self-employed people have called in and sort of said, well, we're left out. Has there been any change that helps us? So yes, now this change will help you. They've changed the formula for the calculation. Instead of the loan amount being based on gross or net profit, it's now based on gross revenue, which will really, really help these 1099 borrowers that you know, sole proprietors, self-employed folks like realtors and subcontractors, charter boat captains on the coast, also independent truck drivers, folks that work for themselves and report
sure.
their revenue with a Schedule C are really going to benefit from this change. It'll increase the loan amount, the funds that they can receive as part of the aid package. And so that's good news. If you haven't applied for one already, you should, right? The program is set to expire at the end of March. Congress, it looks like, as of this morning, it looks like the House is going to vote on a bill next week to extend the program for a few more months. I don't know if the Senate will do that yet or not, but there's still over $100 billion hanging out in the program from the December allocation. So there's plenty of money. And this change will be really good for folks. If you looked at the program, if you're a Schedule C filer, you looked at it last spring and it didn't make sense for you then. You looked at it again in January when the program reopened for you and it didn't make sense to you then. Look at it again, because this change may make sense for you now, and it may make the program helpful to you now. The that's the good news. The bad news is it's not retroactive. And so if you're a Schedule C filer and you've already gotten a first and a second draw PPP loan and you got $500 or $1,000, under this rule, you now qualify for a lot more money, depending on your business's cash flow. But If you got both loans, there's no recourse for you to increase your loan amount. So that was the unfortunate part of this, the fact that they left out the retroactivity. And again, it looks like the House is going to bring up a bill next week to extend the program. I literally just saw the text of the bill, and it does not address the retroactive or the lack of this rule change to have a retroactive feature. So it looks like that's not going to be a solution on this. But so there are going to be some Mississippi businesses that got some assistance that would now technically qualify for more assistance that just are not going to have a path to go forward with it. You know, one of the real challenges in sort of this rule being announced right now is that we're also in tax season. And the CPAs are going to have to do a whole bunch of work to help these 1099 small businesses prepare their loan applications and figure out what their amount under this new formula is going to be. The CPAs are also trying to figure out how to implement all the other tax provisions that came out of CARES and the subsequent COVID relief packages that Congress passed. So
you broke up for a second.
Congress will extend the time, if nothing else, just to give the CPAs some more time to process all of this.
Yeah, you broke up a little bit on us there, Gordon. So you were saying the other thing the CPAs are having to concern themselves with is how to implement, and then we kind of lost you there. I'm sorry. Could you repeat that?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we got you. Yeah.
Great. Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the CPAs, they've got to figure out how to implement all the tax changes that came about as part of CARES,
right,
like the employee
right.
earned credit and all the family medical leave credits and all those credits that came down.
Good point.
It's going to be difficult for them to take this new formula and apply it for these folks all before the end of the month while they're also helping people prepare for taxes in April. So
yeah,
I'm hopeful that Congress will enact this extension just to help the businesses and the CPAs have a little more time to figure out, you know, if they should use this or not.
Yeah, folks may not realize that this is the time of year, this month or so leading up to the April 15th filing deadline. The CPAs are 7 days a week. They're 80 to 100 hours a week cranking out tax returns. It's a big celebration usually on April 15th or 16th, I should say, when they usually take a vacation day to kind of unwind after that. But I didn't think about that. You're right. There was code changes and also some complexities with respect to employer payroll taxes and employer income taxes and so forth that were all part of the 2020 craziness that we had that they've got to deal with. So I think the point there is for people to be patient. It does, however, there's some priorities, are there not, Gordon, given to certain businesses that meet certain qualifications in terms of being eligible for these loans?
Two things happened last week. One was they changed the calculation for Schedule C, and then they also broadened some of the restrictions that restricted certain types of businesses that they can go in and now apply. So I think the message is, if you're an independent business owner, you're self-employed and PPP didn't work for you before, you need to talk to your lender and you need to talk to your CPA soon, because if the program does expire at the end of the month, you need to make sure you take advantage of these changes.